Hello and welcome back to another episode of RSAC TV, the RSA Security Conference's television. And we are here once again from the Moscone Center. And we're talking to some of the great luminaries, security minds, thought leaders who have come to San Francisco for the event. With us in the studio right now, we have Dr. Phyllis Schneck, who is the former Deputy Undersecretary for Cybersecurity Communications at the Department of Homeland Security. Doctor, welcome to RSAC TV.
Thank you. Thank you so very much for having me today.
It's great to have you. So you were, until pretty recently, working within the Department of Homeland Security, and now on to your next adventure in life. Talk to us a little bit about, you were in DHS for about a little more than three years. Talk to us about that experience and kind of what you learned working within the government.
Oh, thank you. It was an amazing experience. I had the privilege to lead a team of 2,000 of the finest scientists and operators in cybersecurity on the planet.
Yep.
The time flew by, and it became very clear that in our government, which we don't get to see very often on the private sector side, we have amazing minds. We have a lot of capability, a lot of operations. I got to watch and help the operations mature, helping our speed of response, using analytics, working with the teams that really build our programs to protect the outside of federal agencies, the inside of federal agencies, tying it together, using that data, building workforce efforts, working with Secretary Johnson and my amazing boss, former Undersecretary Suzanne Spaulding, our Deputy Alejandro Mayorkas, to look at cybersecurity, as the Secretary always said, as part of Homeland Security. Mm-hmm. So what are the parts of cybersecurity in the Coast Guard, the Maritime Mission, or in FEMA, or in Customs and Border Patrol, or ICE, Homeland Security Investigations, Secret Service, that come together to make what is cybersecurity at Homeland Security? And then in my part, to drive those operations to respond and mitigate and help prevent cyber threat all across civilian U.S. government and private sector. And that is a huge effort of a great team that involves more and more of the work of the global cyber community that's here at this conference.
It's funny. I mean, as you describe it to me, it's a huge job. I mean, just the what you just listed off is like 10 different jobs, really. How did you see the role change from the time you kind of came into DHS till when you left?
I think as things happen in technology and as you see in cyber every day, it just gets hotter and hotter every day. So I saw people grow. I saw awareness of what DHS could do from the outside increase.
Yeah.
I saw our team get seen and get noticed, and respect for cybersecurity in U.S. government, I believe, improve. I saw the work that we got to do with the great support of the intelligence community and our partners in the FBI, those relationships get more solid than ever. And certainly the work with the private sector and the understanding on both sides of the need for private sector data and lightning-fast innovation
right.
into what government can do as only government, bringing information together from the intelligence community and other unique government sources, but then to have that information used and consumed by the private sector and to bring cybersecurity awareness across all critical infrastructure. So not just protect a machine, but protect the electric grid.
Right.
And work with our great folks on the Hill to do that. I had the opportunity to witness our Hill staffers, our members of Congress, our senators, our own secretary, embrace cybersecurity and learn it well to the point where they pushed us harder and harder, and it was a great experience.
Right. Talk a little bit about what you are talking about here at the RSA conference and what you're telling attendees.
So I speak, as I am today, as I am here, on behalf of myself and not of the U.S. government.
Yes, right.
And what I brought here was my opinion that I would like to see this global cybersecurity community help work more with and inform better the great scientists that are building across the world our high-performance computing capabilities. Whether it's architecture, algorithms, materials, energy consumption, how we not only apply those to make better and faster machines, but how we leverage the great work of, for example, my former team at the Department of Homeland Security that helped with the help of Congressman McCaul and many others, Senator Carper, many, many others, to get automated indicator sharing inside the National Cybersecurity and Communications Integration Center. Basically, in English, that means that the Homeland Security team is responsible for collecting, with all the expertise of privacy and civil liberties, cyber threat information, indicators, bits and bytes that say this is a warning, putting that together and pushing it back out to the community, and that community then in turn would add to that information and push it back out.
Right.
But what's the next step?
Right.
And really what I want to look at next in my talk, as I described, is how do we use the power of really big computing to make sense of that large load of information that we're now enabling? How do we call on the private sector to build their machines, their hardware, their software, their stuff capable of consuming this information and doing more with it and then sharing it to the places they want to share it, but making sure that the parts of our network that need to be warned are warned? And that takes a lot of analysis, but it also means the products have to be ready to consume it.
It's interesting, when you think about high performance computing, you think of it more in like, you know, Department of Energy or NOAA or something, you know, you're using it to study weather or, you know, do, you know, whatever Department of Energy uses it to do, you know, model nuclear explosion. You don't think of it necessarily as much with cybersecurity and threat detection, but of course, huge applications there, right?
Oh, we have to.
Yeah.
It's modeling, it's simulation, it's visualization, and it's the actual math that might find a trend
right.
that human eyes would never see.
Right.
And we might actually be able to, whether it's we government or we private sector, harness or buy some of that computing time from the national labs or from other services or buy high performance capabilities, but also inform with cybersecurity requirements what the next phase of high-performance computing needs to look like.
Mm-hmm.
Computers are not smart, they're just fast, but let's use that speed mm-hmm. to make our network self-healing.
So what needs to change or be refined on the government procurement side to help kind of direct the market and shape the market to serve the government's needs, I guess, would be a question.
So I'm not a procurement expert.
Yes.
I will say, as a private citizen, having had this great experience in government, I do think that if going forward, the process were easier to buy newer technology
yes.
faster, both government and private sector would be better off. Right. Obviously, private sector has the opportunity to have a shorter sales cycle.
Right.
But the government has the innovation and the technology right there, and it does not have the incentive to try to build it in-house,
right.
which we know takes too long and too much money.
Right. Interesting. And you hear a lot, I mean, here at RSA, obviously a lot of young companies, a lot of smaller companies, very nimble companies, but you do often hear sort of, you know, it's hard to sell to government, you know, because of the way procurement works, and you know, you often have to partner with a larger company who's got the relationship. So yeah, no, it's it can be a challenge that way.
I will throw in a good point though for DHS.
Go they, for
they,
it. Yes.
Our their chief procurement officer came out to events to talk to private sector, to talk about innovative things the department was trying to do to make this cycle easier.
Yes.
And she also sat in meetings with me and my team when I was there to ask us, what is it that government procurement can do to get you the tools you need faster? So
yes.
I do believe they're doing all the right
what
things.
What did you tell her?
The people around the table told her everything they needed, and then I always told her, again, everything I needed as well.
Yes.
But the point was for her to hear from the teams and from the private sector.
Right, right. So, you know, one of the problems, so right now we're in the news, right, we're hearing a lot about top-down review of government IT and cybersecurity. Obviously, there's been a lot of headlines around nation-state-backed attacks and hacking, you know, office personnel management happened. That was, you know, tragic. What would that look like? And is that the right approach, do you think, to take, to do kind of a stand-down and a top-down review? Are there lessons to be learned or intelligence to be gleaned from that? And if so, what? Based, again, on your time in government, what might come out of that?
Sure. I mean, I'll start with saying the progress that I saw the government make and specifically my part of the department make. I'm so proud of that team. You have some of the greatest people in the world on some of the hardest problems, and they're moving them forward.
Yeah.
They did everything I could have asked for and more. I think going forward, one of the challenges that we all have, government and private sector, in my opinion, is that there's a lack of governance clarity. When you want every agency is responsible for their own cybersecurity right now. Now, DHS's role was to raise the bar, to offer a suite of programs that help protect the inside of agencies, the outside, to collect data, to provide analytics.
Mm-hmm.
But if an agency does not want to fully embrace a lot of that, or does not do certain things that use it better, that could also, by them adopting certain programs, make the whole ecosystem stronger,
right.
They can do that. And that made it very, very hard. And usually that's just a function of budget and money and resources. And if there were a way to look at how to alleviate that problem so that it was very clear what the responsibilities are in adopting certain technologies and what the responsibilities are in using them, I think that'll be very helpful. And I'm certain that the folks that go forward will look at this.
Right. Federal government, as you know, moving very aggressively to the cloud for a lot of functions. There's a lot of people who say we should be moving more quickly into the cloud for a lot of reasons, from cost to security. What are your thoughts on how that might change some of the or affect some of the problems that have existed, and also some of the benefits, as well as some of the potential risks of moving more government IT into either public or private clouds?
So this is a great question. It's enormous.
Yes.
There are good things and harder things about moving to the cloud. Let me define the cloud. That means it's someone else's rack room.
Yes.
So you're just doing your processing somewhere
and they send
it back finished. The idea with that is to make to alleviate the need for having your own team or your own IT team for everything and letting some experts or let it get centrally processed and push it back. But there are issues with that as well. For example, secure storage, needing to make sure that information stored on the same piece of memory is not mixed up, or there's no ability to get data, for example, personal information or healthcare information or sensitive, that isn't mixed up. There are service level agreements. There are forensic agreements. If they have to do an investigation, what are the agreements with the service providers? Do they cost the government a lot more money to go in and look in a cloud service versus if they went to your own network?
Right.
You're simply shifting responsibility. One of the great things about the cloud is the scale. And when I was there, we talked about how the cloud would help the government serve sectors such as small to medium business.
Yes.
By taking some of the programs such as continuous diagnostics and mitigation, saying we're able to protect you with the best of private sector inside each agency. Gosh, if that were a service, could we then figure out a way with the private sector to start protecting that small to medium business sector, which is 99% of the business in the US, so that we finally see what's trying to hurt them and let them see it? So there are great, great things about cloud.
Kind of in line with what you were talking about before, sort of government taking the data, but also finding a way to, you know, use it in conjunction with the public sector.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah. Correct.
Interesting. Yeah. So I ask everybody that we talk to, because you're here as a speaker and a subject matter expert, but you're also just at the show and attending the show. What's interesting to you? What has caught your attention? What do you think is new and disruptive?
So I'm seeing a lot of focus on analytics, a lot of focus on words like orchestration, analytics, and I challenged my audience in my talk to how does every different person define those? I think our community really is getting to the point where we're looking at now we have all this information. How do we put it together? How do we use it? People look very energized. The show actually looks a little bigger. It was harder to walk around the expo floor,
indeed,
I think, earlier. Having great people like Congressman McCall and the other keynotes, and certainly a lot of colleagues that I knew before here, is taking this community, and it feels like exactly that, a global community.
Yes.
It's a great show, and that's why I wanted to come and be out here, even though I'm technically on vacation.
A well-deserved vacation, I should
add.
Thank
you.
Yes. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
And thank you so much, Dr. Schneck, for coming in and talking to RSAC TV. We really appreciated it and loved having you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity.
Enjoy the
show.
Thank
you. Thank you.